Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of Colony Drop, a Gundam podcast. My name is Brian.
And my name is Isaac. This is the podcast where we talk about everything Gundam-related, from the movies to the anime series to the models to anything related to the amazing meta-series, meta-genre, that is Gundam.
And what are we talking about today, Isaac?
Today we're talking about capital ships from the one-year war. Oh, yeah.
Oh boy, I know capital ships are a near and dear topic to your heart, just like super weapons were.
You know what? I'm a big Star Wars fan, and I always thought the capital ships in there were awesome, because let's face it, fleet battles are awesome, right? In any sci-fi series you're watching, it's always cool watching two fleets meet up and just duke it out with lasers and weapons. Am I right?
You are right. I mean, that's, you know, I think you get a few different populations of people watching sci-fi, right? You get the people who watch sci-fi where they just want to see, you know, lasers and futuristic technology and people fighting with it. And I think those are the people that really enjoy the capital ship battles. So,
yeah, definitely. And Gundam has plenty of capital ship battles and also lots of different types of capital ships. You know, some sci-fi series you watch and it's like, okay, for example, Star Trek. Oh, I'm about to piss off a lot of Trekkies. But, man, a lot of those Federation ships look the same, right? It's a saucer, and then they slap two engines on the side, right? And they send it out into battle.
Hey, man, it works. You don't change what works.
I guess you're right, and they do pretty good, right? Because the Federation never gets destroyed. But
you know, I will say, I watched The Next Generation growing up on, like, you know, reruns. And yeah, that one episode where the Enterprise splits, you know, between the saucer section and whatever the lower section is called, that blew my mind as a kid.
Yeah, they're like, oh, there was no pause back then, right? I was about to say, pause and like get a drink of water, but no.
Nope, there was no pausing. Yeah.
You had to pick up your corded phone and then you had to like dial a friend who was also watching.
Did you see that? Did you see what they did? Do you have any capital opening remarks? You know, go for it.
You know what? No, I don't. Let's actually just jump into it. I mean, all I'm right. Sure I will after we go into like knee deep into capital ships.
All right, you lead the way. Which one would you like to do first?
We'll talk about the first ship we see in the series, and that is the Musai class from the Principality of Zeon.
Oh man, the Zeon workhorse.
Yeah, this thing. It was actually based on a civilian transport ship, and that transport ship flew upside down. So picture a Musai in your head, listeners, and put it upside down. That's how the ship originally flew. But it was designed in such a way that it could be quickly converted into a warship. So this was clearly a part of Zeon's plan all along, just ramping up to war, having a supply of civilian transport ships on hand that they could just slap some weapons on and be ready for actual space combat and battle.
Not to get us back on Star Trek, but if you turn the Musai, if you turn the Musai around or you know, upside down, it kind of looks like a Zeonic Enterprise.
Yeah, now that you mention it, right? It's got like the long neck and then like a big kind of upper.
Right, it's not a saucer, but yeah, you know, it's got the two engine things in the back, or they look like engines.
Right. There you go again. We're just angering the Trekkies that are listening.
How dare you compare the Enterprise to the Musai?
Yeah. So what I always thought interesting about the Musai was it never had like the same number of weapons as any other Federation warship, right? Like Federation ships are just decked out in all kinds of weapons, and the Musai has, you know, three sets of main guns and then maybe a few others along the side. That's about it. It never struck me as being a really overly gunned.
Yeah, I agree. It definitely seemed like they needed a lot of these, and maybe they just, you know, pumped them out as fast as they could.
Yeah. Also, I always thought it was kind of weird that Zeon didn't find a way to cram more mobile suits in there, because it can only hold 4 to 6 depending on the size. I believe you can hold like 6 Zakus, but only like 4 Doms because they're just too bulky. I always thought it was weird too that they exit out of like that top area. I figured maybe the lower area made more sense, because I figured just looking at it, that looks like where the cargo would go, right? That's just the bulk of the ship.
Yeah, kind of.
But
although it didn't have maybe as many weapons as the Federation ships,
right?
I think it made up for it because it was the first space warship that was, I think, ever designed on either side to carry mobile suits.
Yeah, that's true. And that made all the difference, right? Because if you can carry mobile suits in a space combat and your other side can't, you pretty much win.
That's right.
So the Federation would throw out their little space fighters, but you know, a small group of Musai would be able to send out some mobile suits themselves and, you know, make short work of whatever fleet they were fighting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So a few things on the Musai that I thought were interesting. One, in Gundam the Origin, we see Dozel have his own custom Musai. It's called the Valkyrie. Yeah. And it is 30% larger than a standard Musai. just like Dozel compared to normal men.
That's a good point. It also has like a kind of a pointy tower on it and spikes. He wanted extra spikes on his Musai, just like his uniform.
Right. Yeah, everything is enlarged. So that was kind of neat. Whenever we get a Gundam series, right, because they're not necessarily made, they're all not made at the same time. So every time we get a new series, the designs are updated a little bit or changed a little bit to fit the sort of aesthetic of that series. Do you have a favorite version of the Musai?
Well, definitely not Char's Musai. I always thought that the little helmet bridge, I thought that was just always silly. You know, I know, Char, he has his own helmet and blah, blah, blah. But I always thought that was silly whenever I saw that flying around. I don't think too much of Dozel's because it kind of reminds me of like the Coneheads. Like,
Wow.
Do you remember
I do remember the Coneheads. And now that you say that, that's all I can see is that the one Conehead at the top, and that kind of ruins it for me. So thanks.
Look, Mr. Conehead, we can't customize your Musai. Conehead, the name is Conehead. All right, anyways. But yeah, in Coneheads, they had like actual capital ships too, and they looked a lot like Dozel's Bridge. If you vaguely remember.
I do not remember much about the Coneheads at all. But I do like that you are, working your way through the fandoms today. Yeah, you know, Star Trek, Coneheads.
We're going to have a Coneheads Coneheads podcast coming up soon. We'll talk about the capital ships of the Coneheads. The one that I actually liked appeared in 0083. And I know that's not the one you wore, but hear me out. All those ships that were used by the, you know, Dalaz fleet and the Shima fleet, they were made in the 1 year war, so they still count.
Right.
I like Shima's the Musais in her fleet because they were kind of like a khaki tan color. So I thought that was interesting. Not really something you see. I assume that's the color they painted the fleets for the Gelgoog Marines, and that's the only reason we see them so briefly.
Shima's Gelgoog had that khaki color too, so maybe that was just, you know, her her color, I suppose.
Maybe, yeah. But, I mean, we never see any other fleets that get customized colors. Well, maybe we do in some side stories I haven't seen yet. But I don't know. I thought it was cool that they made such a big deal about them being, oh, these are Gelgoog Marines. They literally only use Gelgoogs. So I guess it figured that they're going to do special operations and missions, so we might as well paint their Musais a special color.
I do like the 0083 one. That one looks the most sinister to me. It's a little curvier than maybe the other ones.
Right, yeah. Very. They modernized the animation to make it look very much like a piece of military hardware.
That makes sense, especially given the time. My favorite is the one from 0083. It's very angular, and I think it looks really evil and a little alien-y.
Alien-y.
Ooh. Yeah. And before you said the Conehead thing, I would have said second place went to the Valkyrie, but
not anymore. What'd you think about the whole the Komusai being on the front of the Musai? Because for our uninformed listeners, a Musai has a reentry capsule, pretty much a shuttle, on the front of the ship. It's literally the bow, like the little pointy nose area. That's able to re-enter Earth's atmosphere. I've never been a big fan of that, because for all the times we've seen Zeon, we don't really see it used that often. Maybe it was used in the early days of the war when Zeon invaded Earth, but for the most part, that Komusai is almost never used in any episode.
Well, it was used. It was used in 8th MS Team, which we just watched for our review last week. That was how they got the Flanagan children off the ship, off the Musai.
Right, but. It's the only time we see it. It's like in a side story. You know, I feel like, I don't know, was the design plan that, oh, we're going to be going back and forth to Earth, guys. You know, we're going to need these shuttles on every one of our main ships. But in actuality, they don't use it. And they probably should have put something else there, like maybe more weapons or, I don't know, more mobile suits.
Yeah, possibly. I mean, I guess it's always a good thing to have, like, an escape ship, I suppose. The only thing is, the only thing is I wouldn't necessarily put my escape ship at the front of my ship where I'm going to potentially take the most fire.
That's true. right, because let's say you're in battle and you're facing off against people, right? You're going to be facing them.
Right.
And your escape craft is going towards the enemy.
Yes.
Unless it's like Battle Alone, where they did pretty much like, you know, they lined up and they fought like old-fashioned sail ships of the line, just
right,
shooting at each other's sides.
Yeah. Speaking of Origin, I think if you want to see the most Musai action, definitely go watch Gundam The Origin.
Yeah. I think the final episode is pretty much the Musai show, right? Yeah. The beginning is actually pretty awesome, too, because you watch, like, Musai just get wasted. Yeah. That's the intro. Like, just a fleet of Musai just being destroyed by, like, Solomuses that were being... I guess the gunners on there were were they the ace gunners or something like that? Because they did not miss.
Yeah. Maybe there wasn't as many Minovsky particles back then.
Something interesting I read, too, is that the word Musai translates into witless. As in lacking wit. So, yeah. I guess Tomino wanted to kind of poke fun at Zeon's coming defeat by giving them such a distinct name for their main ship.
That's funny. I mean, overall, though, I think the Musai is one of Gundam's more iconic capital ship designs, at least definitely on the Zeon side. So,
absolutely.
I think it's a crowd favorite. What do you think?
Yeah, it's definitely probably in the top four, at least, most recognizable ships in Gundam. I'd even say it's the Star Destroyer of Gundam. You see it, you know, that's probably the bad guys. They can be destroyed in large numbers despite their somewhat menacing appearance.
Right? Yes, totally agree.
Yeah,
so. I like it. Yeah. I like the Musai. Good on you, Tamino.
It's a good design. I like it. But moving on, what's next in the side of Zeon, Brian? Or should we hop over to Federation? What do you think?
We can hop back and forth if you'd like. You mentioned Solomus class, so maybe we should tackle the Solomus.
Hey, it's the counterpart to the Musai, right? They go head-to-head.
They do, yeah. So the Solomus is one of the, you know, main ships of the Federation. Like Isaac said, everywhere you see a Musai, you're probably going to see a Solomus class on the other side shooting at it. You know, it's got mega particle cannons. But you know what it can't do? Well, it can, but it wasn't built to hold mobile suits. The irony of the Federation ships are both the Solomus class and the Magellan class, the main ships that they have during the 1 year war. They were built as part of this 70s armament reinforcement plan, where in the UC-70s they, you know, built a bunch of new ships. But ironically, that was before the introduction of mobile suits, so all these ships that they built can't carry mobile suits. So turns out that's a crappy move when you build all your ships based on a non-modern method of warfare.
And they built tons of them. Like, there's thousands of these, possibly, yes. I don't know, tens of thousands.
Yeah, there's a lot of these things.
Yeah.
And but that's, I didn't actually know that before, you know, researching this episode, is that's the reason why you always see all the GMs stacked on the outside, is because there's no room for them on the inside, because that's not how the ships are built.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of implied, because like the Pegasus class was literally their first carrier dedicated for mobile suits. So
you know me, I'm not big on the subtlety.
Yeah. Oh God, can you imagine? Like, so you think the GM pilots are all like just looking at, I guess, their memos or their notes, their assignments, and just hoping that they're assigned to an actual carrier and not like a Solomus, that like their GM won't have to just hold on to like a welded handle on the side of a Solomus.
Yeah, totally, because, you know, at least if you're on, like, okay, first of all, I guess if you're a gym pilot, you're probably gonna die. Like, you have a good chance of maybe not making it, given that the gym's not the best thing.
Brian, there's safety in numbers.
Right? I guess. But, you know, a little shrapnel and those things go down. So, like you said, if you get assigned to a Pegasus class, you at least have a somewhat of a chance to survive while you're just waiting for the battle, because your gym is actually in the ship. But yeah, if you have to sit on a Solimus or a Magellan, you could be like melted by an accidental, you know, mega particle cannon firing near you without even going into battle. So that would be pretty crappy.
Yeah. From what I read, it also obviously made supplying and repairing GMs very difficult in battle. I mean, how would that even work, right? You'd have to have the GM land on the Solimus, grab its little handle, and then hope another carrier's nearby with balls that can resupply it or something like that, right? Like swap out its,
Yeah, you can't take him into the... I mean, there's no bay to take him into. Maybe the idea is you just don't need to repair the gyms. You have so many that if they get damaged, then that's it. You're done. Like, that was your one shot, and you just kind of abandon your gym, and either go back to your crappy Solimus, or you just kind of float around and wait for the battle to be over and someone to pick you up later.
That's a terrible way to run a war. and also the pilots, right? The pilots would pretty much, I assume they're on the Solimus that their GM is strapped to.
Yeah.
So to get into your GM, they open an airlock and line up the pilots and, crawl along the hull, hold this rope or whatever and get to your Solimus.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I guess at least they have those jetpacks, you know, they can fly over.
Yeah.
But yeah, it doesn't seem very efficient.
No, this is, God, the Federation's so lucky they won.
Do you think whoever designed the Solimus and the Magellan got fired, like, once the Zaku's came on the scene, and then they realized that they spent all this money on these ships that can't carry mobile suits?
Well, maybe the person that approved it approved the mass production of thousands or tens of thousands of these ships. Maybe they got fired or, you know, I don't know, demoted or something. But the designers, I mean, they made a really good warship, I think, if you were fighting like just ship-to-ship combat.
Oh, yeah,
because,
for sure.
Yeah, the Solimus is just covered in weapons. So, yeah. I don't know. Yeah, but just from the design of the Solimus, it looks like maybe the Federation had whoever designed their water navy also got put in charge of like their space navy, because this literally looks like they put like a battleship into space. It's or a destroyer. It just has a vertical bridge tower, and then the rest of it is just your typical battleship body lined with guns.
Yeah, just a kind of a long body. Yeah, totally agree. It looks like a ship out of water.
Yeah. Say what you will about the Musai, you know, being on the losing side and all that, but it was a very different looking design that clearly looked like it was designed for space, you know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the Solimus, I've never been a big fan of the design, but it works. Can kind of look at it and see like, oh yeah, this is probably for the good guys because it's, you know, lighter colored and looks pretty, I don't know. If a knight was a ship, it would be the Solimus.
I think it's a good design. It's not definitely not one of my favorites, but the reason I think it's a good design is it's fittingly boring for the Federation, because I think that's what the Federation needs. It looks like a very economical design where they just mass produce a bunch of these things that don't have a lot of character. And that's kind of the Federation, right?
You know, pretty much.
And yeah, if you put the Musai side by side with a Solimus or a Magellan, clearly the Musai has more character than these things.
Yeah, that's true. You think it was like a cost issue maybe, or maybe just time because the war is wrapping up, that they couldn't somehow strap or just build sort of add-ons on the Solimus, like just a housing unit for 3 GMs on each side of the ship or something like that. It was too late by then, and that would take too much. Actually, yeah, I answered my own question, because that meant every Solimus would be refitted, right?
Yeah, plus it's probably easier just to weld the handle on, like you said.
Right, yeah. You could do that with scrap and, you know, the engineers actually on the ship. You wouldn't have to go to a shipyard.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
I answered my own question.
There was a note on MAHQ on the Solimus page that some of these remained in service until at least UC-153, which I was like, wow, that is far out. But that also kind of makes sense because, you know, in the real world, we have a lot of battleships that stay in service for a very long time. Like, if you look like when they were made, they're pretty old. I did not expect that for the Salamises because they're always getting blown up. So I would have thought that, you know, who would want those that late? But kind of neat.
Yeah, I'd assume as time went on, they were almost never on the front lines. Like, they're probably just doing supply runs or something like that, right?
Yeah, they got to be in the back. Yeah.
God help.
Support fire or something.
God help you if you're in a Salamis and you're fighting in the year. Would you say UC-150?
Yeah.
Those poor souls.
So, you know, alongside the Salamis, the other sort of workhorse of the Federation fleet was the Magellan class.
Yeah.
And it kind of looks like a better Salamis. You know, if you're not super familiar with the designs and you've only maybe watched one or two Gundam series, you probably wouldn't know the difference if it was just in a fast-paced battle. They kind of look almost the same to an untrained eye or someone who hasn't watched, you know, quite a bit of Gundam. The Magellan is kind of just the better version of the Salamis. You know, I think it has like one more like megaparticle cannon. And I think the only really thing that I thought was notable about the Magellan versus the Salamis, I mean, everything kind of still, all the same comments kind of still apply in my opinion, but General Rebel's flagship was a Magellan class. The Ananke, am I saying that right?
I think it was called Ananke or something. It's pronounced somehow.
Yeah. Ananke.
Word of advice, anyone in the military that's in charge of naming ships, it has to be something we can say. Like, don't rely on the, like, just text, you know, because there's different ways to pronounce things. So.
Yeah. Unfortunately for him, you know, in the origin, his flagship was destroyed by the Black Tri-Stars and he was captured.
The Salamis is like a destroyer, then the Magellan's a battleship. So it's definitely a few classes bigger than it. Kind of a cheat way to tell the difference is if you look at the bow of a Salamis, it's vertical. And if you look at a Magellan, it gets kind of flat. I think that's actually more of a smart design because the Magellan has these two big guns right in the front. So I think that gives it way more coverage. But overall, it's bigger. If you were bullying the Salamis, then the big brother, the Magellan, would probably show up and fight you and beat you. So that's a good way to look at it. We actually see the Magellan in the first episode. I forgot the officer's name that like talking to Amuro a lot, but he's like, oh, you know, we're going to send out the Magellan or something and like slap around the Zeon. But I think it actually gets destroyed, if I remember correctly, or at least heavily damaged. No, I think it gets destroyed. But do you remember the Magellans all being green?
No, I thought they were blue and gray, kind of like the Salamises. The only green one that I'm aware of is the ones in Mobile Suit Gundam Igloo kind of have like a gray tinge on them, I guess. Maybe that's just more the animation style. It's like CG, you know, but all the other ones I thought were like a bluish gray.
Yeah, for the most part. But I do remember seeing at least the first one we see in 0079 is almost an emerald. I always thought that was weird because that was too close to Zeon. I thought it was definitely, it wasn't the, you know, the sort of military avocado green, but it was a brighter kind of emerald green. So I always thought that was weird. So maybe they animated that and then they thought, oh, this is way too close to the bad guys. We need to make them more similar to the Salamis' color.
So, yeah, that's interesting. Yeah. I mean, 0079 had a lot of bright color choices, so it wouldn't surprise me if they played around with some of the colors at some point in the series.
Probably not. But these are the Federation's two main ships, their two main warships, the Magellan and the Salamis. But I don't think there's a lot of people that care for them too much because, as you said, Brian, they're a little bland. They're battleships with thrusters.
Yeah. And they're essentially overshadowed by the star of the show, which is the Pegasus class carriers. Right. But one last thing I wanted to say about the Salamis and the Magellan before we moved on is that there was that really cool scene in the origin. I don't remember if they were Salamis class or Magellan class, but where we get to see them take off from Earth, those extra booster rockets. Ooh. To go to the Battle of Loom, and that was super cool.
Right.
Sky
was covered in them, right?
Yeah, that was really neat. I can't remember if we'd seen that in another series before, but I thought that was really neat. So again, if you want to see Musai action, you know, if you want to see hot Musai on Salamis and Magellan action, go watch Gundam The Origin, because it has the biggest fleet battle, you know, in Gundam, the Battle of Loom. So
honestly, I thought the Magellans and the Solnuses were all built in space. I didn't think they were built on Earth and then just boosted out. I guess it does make sense that they were, because there's a lot of resources on Earth, right? That's why Zeon wanted to take over it. So
yeah,
interesting.
I mean, I guess certainly if you could build them in space, that would save a lot of time and effort. Hopefully those booster rockets are like Elon's rockets that land themselves and they don't have to throw them away every time.
No, they had to throw them away every time.
they're one use.
Come on. What do you think is going on?
All right. Which ship is next on your list, Isaac?
How about we talk about the Chevet class? So the Chevet doesn't show up very often, really, in any story. We do see it very briefly near the end of the one-year war in 0079. What happens is there's an admiral, and he fights the Gundam with lead that uses Chevet-class heavy space cruisers, and you know they get destroyed, of course. I don't really have too much to say about this ship other than that it almost feels like a ship that has no purpose, right? Because why build this? It's not big enough like a Guazine. It's certainly not a Zanzibar where it can, you know, go into Earth's atmosphere and all that. And it's bigger than a Musai. It has more weaponry, but, you know, it can still hold about the same amount of mobile suits. Well, a little bit more, but really two more than a Musai. That doesn't make much of a difference. So this is something that I think Zeon designed and probably wasn't too well thought out. So not much to say about the Chevet, Brian. Did you have anything to add to it?
So I thought the Chevet could not carry mobile suits because it was designed before.
Right.
Yeah. Did they add, I guess they added that on later on.
Well, it wasn't purpose. Let me correct myself. It wasn't purpose built for mobile suits, but the cargo area is spacious enough that they could cram mobile suits in there.
Oh, okay.
Got so it. They kind of got around it. I don't know why the Solomus and Magellan can't make cargo room. I don't know what the hell happened over there.
Because they're big, yeah. Narrow, you know. The Solomus, we're looking at pictures, but listeners, you're obviously not listening at pictures. A Solomus and a Magellan are basically very narrow rectangles that go into battle. The Chevet has a little more, you know. It's a little thicker than the Solomuses and the Magellans.
It's a chunky ship. It's kind of short, stubby, and thick. It's I can clearly see where they would put the mobile suits. So it, but I mean, this ship, you know, it doesn't have that many more guns than a Musai, and it's not big enough to rival the Guazine. I just feel like it was such a misplaced ship. It didn't really have an actual dedicated role in the Zeon fleet, so I guess it's a good idea. It's good for Zeon that they didn't build too many, because we certainly didn't see too many.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it was the precursor to the Musai, and once you needed mobile suits, I think the Musai won out. So that's why you see a lot more than the Chevet. But they're kind of neat looking. They're very I don't know. It just reminds me of like a bug for some reason.
Yeah.
Definitely an evil Zeon look for the, you know, 1979 or 1980. I can see that.
Yeah. I don't know. I wish maybe we saw them more often in Musai fleets. Like, you'd know that was always, you know, the Admiral's ship or something like that.
Yeah.
Maybe it was too much to animate. You know, it's so much easier just to recycle Musai animation for the,
yeah.
for the production team.
All right. Next up. There is one other Federation ship that we didn't talk about with the Solomus and the Magellan that's basically the same thing, but it's a different class, and that's the Lepanto class. I think this is only seen in Origin. I don't remember it being in any other shows, but it's like a missile frigate. It's a little smaller than the Solomus class, but it's pretty much just sits there and launches missiles. But yeah, pretty much the same design. It looks like a marine battleship put in space. But I think because it was designed for Origin, it has a little bit more of like a modern design. So it actually looks pretty cool. You know, I wish like kind of like the Solomus looked like that one, the Lepanto. It's got like one lone cannon, one lone megaparticle cannon, which is kind of funny.
Do you remember it doing well against mobile suits? Like, or was it?
Probably not. I mean,
that's too bad.
It's basically like an artillery, you know, thing that sits in the back, I think.
Figured like it was kind of their ace in their ace in the hole for mobile suits. Like, oh, we'll just, good thing we brought these. We'll kind of spam missiles at them. But
yeah,
the missiles were probably too slow or too large, and the mobile suits could just dodge them, fly around them.
I mean, if the Salamis and the Magellan didn't do well, I can't imagine that Lepanto did well.
Probably not. Speaking of ships that are sort of, you know, half Salamis or half Magellan, there's a ship called a Trafalgar class, which was, it was essentially just a Magellan, and then they slapped two docking bays on each side of it, along with mobile suit catapults. So it could actually hold a lot of mobile suits. It could hold up to 72 mobile suits, and that's a lot, especially for one ship.
72? Holy crap.
Yeah, it's a lot, right?
Wow.
But, I mean, this wasn't a dedicated ship. It was clearly, you know, just add-ons to a Magellan, and they didn't build that many. They only built 8.
Oh, wow. So. Yeah, I've never heard of the Trafalgar class. But right. Yeah, that definitely looks like someone kit-bashed a model.
Pretty much,
like,
right?
Like they had leftover pieces from a white base or something, and they glued them to the side of a Magellan.
This is clearly like a missing link, though, right? Because those launch bays look literally like something you'd see later on in the UC, like from the Grips conflict or on the Rockai Loom or something like that.
Yeah, definitely. But,
I don't know if the ship was at a battle coup. I don't think it was. Maybe they were on the way and then the war ended.
Oh.
Yeah, but I don't know. I thought it was interesting that the Federation did manage to sort of throw together these super carriers at the last minute, but didn't see a lot of action and didn't build a lot of them.
Yeah.
There's a couple more in the Federation I wanted to talk about. One of them is the Columbus. So the Columbus was an unarmed vessel, but it really became the workhorse of the Federation towards the end of the war because it was able to carry up to 20 mobile suits. And there were a lot of Columbuses. It was the main reason that the Federation was able to move around their GMs at the end of the 1 year war. So they were actually big enough that if they crashed into a Salamis, which happened often in combat, especially during major battles like a battle coup, they would actually destroy the Salamis and their own ship. So these weren't small ships; they were unarmed, unfortunately. But they're with the whole fleet at that point, so it didn't make too much of a difference. And design-wise, I always kind of liked them. You know, it was such a simple design, but it made a lot of sense. There's just, it's essentially two drums almost, two barrels laying on their side, and inside there's either the cargo or the mobile suits. Yeah. Columbus.
Yes, speaking of the Columbus, there was one special Columbus called the Beehive, which was in, I think that's from Gundam Thunderbolt.
Yeah.
And it's basically like two Columbus ships put together.
Right.
So I imagine, it probably doubled or at least somewhat increases the mobile suit carrying capacity. That one looked pretty cool, given that it's a transport ship. But I believe that one, they did add some guns on that one. So
probably. And, it was Thunderbolt, so there's a fleet around it helping it out. So it's not defenseless.
Plus, I really like the name Beehive, given that it's this transport ship for mobile suits. I think that's a really fitting name. So I like that one. It's pretty cool.
You think they named it that because if you look at the sort of carrying containers on the Columbus, they're shaped like the hexagons on a beehive?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, definitely. With the name like Beehive, though, I figured they'd stack more or something like that, right? Like it'd be like a grid. It'd be a whole grid of Columbus classes.
Yeah, with a name like Beehive, I agree. I almost feel like it should be stationary and it shouldn't move.
Something like that, or I don't know. 8 minimum. You need to stack 8 of these minimum.
we want more pods, more hexagonal pods.
Yeah. All right, let's hop over to Zeon again, Brian. Name one of the new, one of the remaining Zeon mobile suits. One of the remaining Zeon capital ships.
All right, how about the Dolos class?
Ah, the Dolos, God. The beasts of the Bawaku.
Giren Zabi's, his little pet project besides the colony laser. Yeah, there you go.
They probably left it there, right?
I mean, I would imagine so.
The point, yeah.
Yeah, but apparently it carries 182 mobile suits. MAHQ says that's the largest dedicated mobile suit carrier ever built. I mean, 182?
It's insane. That's too much.
I totally agree. I think that's too much. If the thing goes up in flames, then you just lost 182 mobile suits. You better get them all out of there. But that's the drawback, isn't it, Isaac?
Absolutely, because okay, God, I can understand wanting to build like a super ship, right? A super carrier or something like that. But the major design flaw with the Dolos class is it only has 7 launch catapults. So I think I read somewhere that it took like 6 hours for them to launch their entire, you know, their entire carrying capacity, all their mobile suits, which is insane.
MAHQ says 20 minutes, but yeah.
Well,
still
20 minutes.
That's a long time in a battle.
Yeah. All right. Well, we have mixed information. But anyways, actually 2 of these ships were built and they were ironically both destroyed at the same battle.
So if the guy who approved the Salamis class and the Magellan class got fired, and whoever only designed 7 catapults into the Dolos class for Garen probably got executed.
Maybe. Oh, no, he sneaked by because of the coup, the Republic of Zeon gets formed, right? So I assume he was fine. Maybe he got sent to the Federation for, they probably wanted to recruit him to design ships or something.
But yeah, I can't see how you build this giant ship to do the one thing and then you screw up the door for that one thing.
Yeah. You know what? I'm going to say Garen was involved in this because only his arrogance would create something like this. Instead of building however many Musais we could have built and had a much more flexible fleet, he wanted just 2 super carriers that just easily become the main targets of the enemy fleet. And yeah, they just were destroyed. Yeah. I think they were destroyed within 30 minutes of each other.
Sad.
Yeah. In their defense, though, yes, they were able to hold a lot. Great engineering. And I think they also had like the longest range mega particle beam cannons in the war.
Yeah. This really reminds, I mean, you're a World War II guy. This really reminds me of, do you know what the Tirpitz is?
Yeah, wasn't that a battleship?
Yeah, it was this enormous battleship that Germany had built during World War II. The Allies were so, not afraid of it, but, you know, they knew that they had to, like, take this thing out, and they figured out where it was because there was only one dock big enough to, like, dock the Tirpitz. And there's a great, great little documentary on it. I highly recommend it, called The Greatest Raid of All. It's narrated by Jeremy Clarkson. And it was kind of like a, not to get too much into it, but it was kind of like a suicide mission. These British soldiers basically took off with no real way home. And their goal was to blow up the dock because the thought was, well, if that's the only place that the Tirpitz can dock and you blow it up, then the Tirpitz is screwed. and you know, it all worked out in the end. But I wonder if the Dolos is somewhat inspired by the Tirpitz or a similar, you know, huge ship from World War II, given the other World War II parallels from, you know, the 1 Year War.
Right. It must be inspired by just those failed Axis gambits to try to just build some type of big, powerful super weapon that would turn the course of the war. But ultimately, it was just a misplaced resources that probably should have gone somewhere else if you were more reasonable and rational. God, how many mobile suits could they have built? You know, even mobile armors might have been a better choice because they probably could have performed really well against GMs and the Federation fleet compared to 2 super carriers that are just lumbering about.
Yeah. Went up in flames.
Yeah.
I've always said, give me more big Zoms, man.
And a little tidbit, fans. Gato was stationed on one of the Dolos classes.
Oh, yeah. Interesting.
It was pretty sad when it blew up for obvious reasons. Maybe he had friends on there or something. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah. 182 friends by chance?
Maybe. I just, let's be honest. There's no way he knew every other pilot there.
And we're going to cut it there for this episode. Next week, we'll continue our rundown of capital ships from the 1 Year War, including the Great Degwin and the Pegasus class.
Please like, comment, and subscribe. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts and on Twitter at Colony Dropcast. As always, keep those Minovsky reactors warm, stay safe, and have a great week, everybody.